Good morning, everyone. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to Trinity and to our service today. My name's Alex. I'm ministry team leader here, and it's very good to welcome you, whether you're in the room here or for those of you joining online. It's good to gather together and worship God. Psalm 95 says, "Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into God's presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods." So for whatever reason you're here today, for whatever reason you're tuning in, let's not let this be an accident that we're here, but let's take this opportunity to come into God's presence, to bring God who we are, where we're at, everything that we have with us, the burdens we carry, everything about us, to come into God's presence and give God our worship and our praise and discover his love for us. So our first hymn, I'm going to hand over to the worship band, and we're going to, first hymn is a hymn of welcome, "Come All You Vagabonds," but I'll hand over to Chris, who may or may not want to say more. Who knows?
Morning, everybody. Now, all I had was that verse from Matthew 10, where Jesus is sending the disciples out into the world, and he says, "Whoever welcomes you welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me." So know that you are very, very welcome here this morning. So come all you vagabonds. Please stand, or you can remain seated if you wish. 1, 2, 3, 2, 3. We sing "From the highest heights to the depths of the sea, indescribable." 1, 2.
Be seated. Let us pray. Lord, you are amazing, and we are all struck in your presence. Lord, you hold all things in your hands, from the vastness of the universe, the stars in the sky that we can see, down to the smallest subatomic particle. Lord, you know it all and you hold it all in your hands. Lord, thank you that though you are the God of the universe, yet you know each one of us and call us by name, that you know us intimately, you know everything about us, and you love us. Lord, we are awestruck by your love that is beyond our comprehension, beyond what we can understand, beyond what we could know. Lord, it's amazing that you hold us in your hands and that your hands bear the scars of your sacrifice for us when Jesus gave his life for us on the cross. Lord, thank you that we are written on the palm of your hands and you love us and you welcome us and you delight in us, and you send the Holy Spirit to us to bring us into the fullness of your life. So we pray, Lord, that as we worship you today, we pray that as young people go to their groups and learn about you through in the hall, and for those of us who remain in the church, we pray whatever we do this morning, this afternoon, this evening, and in the days to come, we will know more of your love, that you will call us deeper into that fullness of life that you offer. We pray that you will just lead us on day by day as we seek to follow Jesus and walk in your new life. So, Lord, we place ourselves into your hands willingly with all that we have and are. And we come to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. So, as hinted in the prayer, the young people and children are going to go to your groups now. We look forward to seeing you later. And those of us who are staying in the church, we're going to listen to some Bible readings, two Bible readings. To begin with, we're going to continue with the story of Abraham in the book of Genesis. And then we're going to hear from part of the story of Jesus in Matthew's Gospel. So Tom and Miriam are going to read for us. Thank you.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is taken from Genesis chapter 18, the Son of Promise. Then the Lord appeared to him by the terebinth trees of Mamre, as he was sitting in the tent door in the heat of the day. So he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, three men were standing by him. And when he saw them, he ran from the tent door to meet them, and bowed himself to the ground and said, "My Lord, if I had now found favor in your sight, do not pass on by your servant. Please let a little water be brought, and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. And I will bring a morsel of bread, that you may refresh your hearts, and that you may pass by, inasmuch as you have come to your servant." They said, "Do as you have said." So Abraham hurried into the tent to Sarah and said, "Quickly, make ready three measures of fine meal, knead it, and make cakes." And Abraham ran to the herd and took a tender and good calf, gave it to a young man, and he hastened to prepare it. So he took butter and milk and the calf which he had prepared and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree as they ate. Then they said to him, "Where is Sarah, your wife?" So he said, "Here, in the tent." And he said, "I will certainly return to you according to the time of life. And behold, Sarah, your wife, shall have a son." Sarah was listening in the tent door, which was behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, well advanced in age, and Sarah had passed the age of childbearing. Therefore, Sarah laughed within herself, saying, "After I have grown old, shall I have pleasure, my Lord being old also?" And the Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh, saying, 'Shall I bear a child since I am old?' Is anything too hard for the Lord? At the appointed time, I will return to you according to the time of life, and Sarah shall have a son." May God add his blessing to his word.
Morning. Our New Testament reading this morning is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 9, beginning at verse 35 and then continuing through chapter 10. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered, like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." And when he had called his 12 disciples to him, he gave them power over unclean spirits, to cast them out, to heal all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease. Now the names of the 12 apostles are these: first, Simon, who was called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, who also betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out, and he commanded them, saying, "Do not go into the way of the Gentiles, but do not enter a city of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, 'The kingdom of heaven is at hand.' Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. Freely you have received, freely give. Provide neither gold nor silver nor copper in your money belts, nor bag for your journey, nor two tunics, nor sandals, nor staffs, for a worker is worthy of his food. Now whatever city or town you enter, inquire in it who is worthy, and stay there till you go out. And when you go into the household, greet it. If the household is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. And whoever will not receive you or hear your words, when you depart from that house or city, shake off the dust from your feet. Assuredly, I say to you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city." May the Lord bless you.
We're going to sing together a hymn, "Seeking God's Renewal," the renewal of the Holy Spirit. "Lord, your church on earth is seeking your renewal from above." Let's sing. When I was a young Christian, and a young person, I may add, my heroes were people like David Wilkerson. Do you remember David Wilkerson wrote The Cross and the Switchblade? My youth leader read a chapter of The Cross and the Switchblade to us every week. And it was so exciting about this pastor who felt called by God to go in the 1950s to New York City and take the gospel, the good news of Jesus, to the gangs who were, really terrorizing the city. And he went, and it was a very exciting story. I also remember reading the biography of James Hudson Taylor, who in the early 19th century felt the call of God to take the good news of Jesus to inland China. Missionaries had been to some of the coastal cities of China, like Hong Kong and Shanghai, but no one had been into the interior, where there were millions of people, and Hudson Taylor just felt the compassion of God for those people and went to China and started living like a Chinese person, even to take the good news of Jesus to them. I thought, wow, I want to be like that. I want to be like that. And in the late 70s, early 80s, some of you will remember, there was quite a big Christian music scene, and there were bands going around. These days, all Christian musicians, professional ones, seem to be in worship bands. But in those days, they were evangelistic. They were going around to village halls I saw Adrian Snell at the Hammersmith Odeon, which was incredible. He filled the Hammersmith Odeon even for a Christian rock concert. And they'd have a message, there'd be a message in the songs, there'd be a testimony in between. It was about taking the good news to people. And I was in bands not filling the Hammersmith Odeon. We pretty much filled Leatherhead Methodist Church Hall. Giving a message, songs with a message, because we wanted to tell the good news. It's all about evangelism. I spent time with Operation Mobilization, going and doing street theater in Belgium and trying to sell evangelistic books door to door in Coventry and Ghent and Berlin and all these sorts of places. I had stickers on my pencil case at college and on my folders. Like take out college, they had things like Jesus Christ, he's the real thing. Anyone remember those stickers? Look like Coca-Cola. Jesus Christ, he's the real thing. Thank God for Jesus. All sorts of things. Because it was this kind of message. You've got to get out there and tell the good news to people. Be a missionary. Be an evangelist. Go out. I was never really very good at it. I was scared of what my stickers might produce. I was scared of the conversations that the badge on my lapel might produce. I used to get my folders out of my bag and open them as quickly as I could, so no one had a chance to read the stickers and ask me an awkward question I might not be able to answer. So I wanted to evangelize. I wanted to be like these heroes of mine, but I was never very good at it. So if you're here today and you've heard those sermons, possibly from me, you heard those sermons and you're here today sharing some of my guilt and sense of inadequacy when it comes to telling people about Jesus and what God's done for you. Or if you're here today wanting to know more about God, and more about God's love, and someone's told you something about it, and you're exploring it, or you're tuning in to find out more. The message of the Bible readings we've got today, and I hope it's a good news message, is that all of us, whether you've been a Christian since the late 70s or earlier, or whether you're just exploring it, all of us discover more of God's love through hospitality and friendship, and that's where we start. Hospitality, friendship, being alongside, just being a person alongside other people. And you know how to do that. Matthew starts with the compassion of Jesus. Jesus is out and about doing his thing, and all these crowds are coming to him, and he's telling them his stories, and he's healing the sick, and so on. And he's got all these crowds, and he's moved with compassion for them. They're weary, they're helpless, they're lost, like a sheep like sheep without a shepherd. And so he sends his 12 of his disciples, his kind of core group, names them apostles, which means sent, and he sends them on mission. But at the core of it, as you read how he sends them, they're not sent to go as kind of imperialistic saviors with all the answers to, you know, and that's it. But they're sent to travel alongside. If you look at the way Jesus sends them, they are sent with nothing. He says, don't take a purse, don't take a spare tunic, don't take a spare pair of sandals, don't even take a bag. Go, and if you find someone of peace, go in and eat with them. Go and stay with them. He sends them out to be dependent on the people they go to need something from the people they're going to. He sends them out with a message. They're sent to proclaim the good news of the kingdom of heaven, the message Jesus has been giving. They're sent with a task to do the kind of things Jesus has been doing, to heal the sick, to cleanse lepers, to raise the dead even, to cast out demons and so on. So they've got something to offer. They're going with something, but they are also going without something. And their material dependence makes for this kind of dynamic relationship of give and take with the people they meet. It's a relational approach built around the sharing of gifts. The disciples had the message of good news and healing and so on, and the people they stayed with had food, somewhere to stay, a roof. They each had something to offer, and into that hospitable space that the disciples were sent out to create on their journeys, into that hospitable space, the kingdom of heaven, the rule of God, breaks in and new life emerges. So, mission and evangelism then start with friendship. Telling someone the good news of Jesus starts with listening to them in that kind of spirit of hospitality. Sharing the gift of how God is blessing you starts with also receiving what the person is offering you. Sharing the love of God starts with being friendly. And you know how to be friendly. I know you know how to be friendly. And let's not be put off by these 12 apostles. We don't, as I've said recently, we never hear of most of them through the book of Acts and through the story of the church. There are legends about some of them, but most of them we don't really know what goes on. I don't think, this is my theory, and you can argue with me if you like later, because it's only my theory, but that Jesus didn't go around the area interviewing lots of people, shortlisting, making sure that his team was going to have, you know, the full spread, cover all the bases of the gifts and the abilities that he was going to need. He didn't check that he'd got a good spread of Jungian personality types or across the Enneagram or anything like that. He didn't go around doing that. He saw a couple of fishermen. He said, hey, follow me. And they said, yes, all right, and they followed him. He saw Matthew, the tax collector, at his customs booth, and he said, follow me. And Matthew said, yes, all right, and followed him. I think they were chosen perhaps just for their availability, their willingness to be available to Jesus. They said yes to Jesus. And you can do that. Jesus was all about the world becoming the way God wants it to be. And in the biblical vision of that, in the Old Testament and the prophets, it kind of, you can boil it down to a vision of every person and every living thing living together in peace, in life in its fullness, in the abundance of God. And I think, therefore, the 12 that Jesus chose to be at the core of his mission could have been anyone. And it was important that they could have been anyone. They simply said yes to Jesus and learned how to make themselves vulnerable and open up that space so that the Holy Spirit could change them and bring them into that fullness of life. They said yes to Jesus. And you could do that. I think Abraham's quite a good model of this kind of hospitality. It's a brilliant story, that one in Genesis chapter 18. And I had to kind of choose this morning which one we were going to focus on, because just of time constraints. But maybe another time we'll look more into it. It's a really rich story. But simply, if we look at the way that Abraham was so eager to offer hospitality to the visitors that called, we know, the readers, that it was the Lord, that one of them was an angel or one of them was even God. Or perhaps they were all God, we're not sure. But Abraham didn't know that, but he was a hospitable person. He had been called originally, as we heard last week, if you were in the service, to be blessed in order to be a blessing. God said to him, I will bless you, and all the nations of the world will be blessed through you or in you, or will bless themselves in you. Called to be blessed in order to be a blessing. And Abraham was so eager to be a blessing that hospitality he offered led to a new word coming from God, a more committed word, a more committed promise, when it seemed to Abraham and Sarah that time had run out on the promises that they'd been given. Here comes a new word that brings new life for them out of that hospitable space. So for us, Trinity, as a church, how can we be more hospitable and welcoming? How can we create a hospitable space in which we discover more of the life of the Holy Spirit and the gifts of God and share them together? I think that the more we as a church can welcome and become broadly welcoming and welcome that diversity and hear each other's stories and learn from each other's different perspectives, the more we can do that, the more we will express what Paul says in Ephesians 3 is the rich variety of God's wisdom. And it will also make us stronger and more resilient in this uncertain and fast-changing world. The kingdom of heaven is about a peaceful community in which all flourish. And we flourish when we're in good relationships, when we're in community. So let's work at practicing hospitality as a church, but also individually, as we give hospitality, but also have the grace to receive the gifts of others when they're offered, to come alongside, to give and to receive. To come with the blessing of God, but also to find God within that space that we open up in the friendship, in the relationship. Also, it's a good idea to practice gratitude. Then perhaps you don't have to get your pencil case out so quickly. Perhaps you have a practice of gratitude. Giving thanks every day for something gives us good news to share. So when the moment comes when someone asks the awkward question, are you a Christian? Why are you a Christian? What do you go to church? You've got something to say. What's God done for me today? What's your testimony? What good news do you have? The practice of gratitude, the practice of giving thanks will all mean you'll always have good news to share. And if you're here today wanting to know more of the love of God, then you can open the door to Jesus and say yes to Jesus. In Revelation 3, there's that picture of Jesus says, I stand at the door knocking. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I'll come into them and eat with them. So wherever you're at today, come to the feast. There is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place with the King of all kindness who welcomes us in with the wonder of love and the power of grace. Let's come. Amen. Andrew's going to lead us in our prayers for the world as we seek God's blessing on the world and on ourselves.
When I say, in your mercy, would you respond with, hear our prayer? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we know the abundance of your love. We know the abundance of your hospitality. And experienced your care and provision for each one of us. you invite us to extend that love to the world around us, to care for others as deeply as we care for ourselves. And so now we bring to you the needs of the world. In your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the many in our world and in our communities who do not have enough, who struggle to find food to eat or shelter to keep warm, for those who don't have enough employment to make ends meet, money to pay their bills, or enough medicine for medical care. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We also pray for those who have enough, but who still struggle to find meaning and purpose in life. For those who indulge in dangerous and self-serving activities to dull the pain of loneliness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are empty emotionally, who are lonely and long for companionship and love, who are caught in the grip of depression or overwhelmed by grief. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are spiritually empty, who are troubled but do not know where to turn, who long for purpose and meaning but don't know where to look, those who need you but don't yet know you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, we praise you for your abundant gifts in our lives. We ask that you pour out your Spirit on us as well, filling us with your compassion and with your love, so that we would willingly share some of our abundance with those who have need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, your grace reaches out to all of us. You call us to live as citizens of heaven, to follow you, working together with one heart and one mind. Strengthen us to live in a manner worthy of the good news we have received, offering our lives in service of your kingdom, where the last are first, and the first are last, and there is grace enough for all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Saviour and Lord. Amen. Let's say together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I receive the offering. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that you'll receive these gifts that we bring and the other ways in which we give. And we pray that they might release in us generosity of heart and spirit, that all we have and all we are might be shared with you for the blessing of the world. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to come to the communion table in a minute, but as we prepare to gather around it, we sing, God is love, His the care. Sing aloud. Please be seated. So this is the Lord's table, and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I welcome you to come and to take bread and wine and to remember him and the way he showed God's love for us in his death and resurrection. You all welcome. This is an open table, and if you're sitting downstairs, you'll be invited to come forward and take bread and wine. And you can return the glass to the table there or take it to your seat and consume it there if you would prefer. If you are not able to come forward, then when everyone's been served, Andrew and I will come find you. But you may need to just catch our eye so we don't miss you. Okay, we don't want anyone to feel left out who wants to take part. If you're in the gallery, the elements will be brought to you where you're sitting. The bread is gluten-free. The wine is alcohol-free, so hopefully you can take part.
Let us celebrate this joyful feast. People will come from east and west, north and south, and sit at the table in the kingdom of God. Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest." And the Apostle Paul wrote these words to the church in Corinth, saying, I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he'd given thanks, he broke it, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And Paul adds, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So as Jesus gave thanks on that last supper with his friends, let us give our thanks to God. Let us pray. Holy and blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe. In the beginning you brought light out of darkness, life out of clay. When in Adam we disobeyed, you did not cease loving us. When we were slaves in Egypt, you led us to freedom through the Red Sea. When we wandered in the wilderness, you gave us bread and revealed the law to be our guide. You brought us over Jordan to the promised land, but we were unfaithful and would not listen to your prophets. Yet even in the bitterness of exile and the harshness of oppression, your faithfulness has always surrounded us. In the fullness of time, you sent your Son, Jesus, to be the living bread and the fulfillment of the law. Born of Mary, baptized by John, he lived among us and proclaimed your kingdom, healed the sick, ate with outcasts, bound up the brokenhearted, challenged the proud. Yet he was betrayed, tortured, and crucified. In anguish of spirit, he opened his arms and gave up his life. But out of the depths, you raised him up, broke the power of the enemy, and won for us forgiveness of our sins by the power of his cross. You exalted him as Lord of life to reign with you eternally, victorious over sin and death. We pray that now you'll send your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine, that they may be for us his body and blood, and in receiving them we may be healed and renewed to serve you in the world. Bring us together from east and west and north and south to sit with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and all those who have gone before us. Join us in unity in your spirit around this table. We ask this through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who with you, Father, and the Holy Spirit reigns now and forever. Amen. Christ, our Passover has been sacrificed for us, so let us keep the feast. The bread which we break is the communion in the body of Christ. And the cup of blessing, which we bless, is a communion in the blood of Christ. So draw near with faith. Keep you in eternal life. Body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Body of Christ, 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 keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. Body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ, keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. The body of Christ keep you in eternal life. Body of Christ, 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 keep you in eternal life. body of Christ keep you in eternal life.
Thank you.
Life.
Thank you.
You
Let us pray. Most gracious God, we praise you for what you have given and for what you have promised us here. You have made us one with all your people in heaven and on earth. You have fed us with the bread of life and renewed us for your service. Now we give ourselves to you, and we ask that our daily living may be part of the life of your kingdom, and that our love may be your love, reaching out into the life of the world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So two little notices before our last hymn. One is you're invited to come round to the Derwent Hall behind me for coffee afterwards. You'd be very welcome to do that. And the other thing is that I think the young church are going to be coming back while we sing the hymn. And we have some heroes for fathers for you. So I think it's the idea is if you're a father, or if you would like to take one and give it to your father if he happens to be here, or if you'd like to take one and remember your father as you eat the chocolate, I think that's an option as well. It's whatever it's going to mean for you, I think, is the idea. And the young people will come in and distribute those for Father's Day. So we're all heroes, aren't we? There we are. That could have gone better. But anyway, we're going to stand and sing our last hymn, Christ Be Our Light, Shine in Our Hearts, Shine in the Darkness. Well, let's go into God's world in the power of the Holy Spirit to live and work to God's praise and glory and share the good gifts that he gives to us all. And as we go, may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with us and stay with us always. Amen. And let's say the grace to one another. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.